I Let us pray. Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ, your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up, and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance, beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the sons of man. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which had not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before the Lord like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. And as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. Each has turned to their own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Redeem me, O Lord, faithful God. the scorn of all my adversaries, a horror to my neighbors, an object of dread to my acquaintances. Those who see me in the streets flee from me. I have passed out of mind like one who is dead. I have become like a broken vessel. Trust in you, O Lord. I say you are my God. My times are in your hands. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors. Servant, save me in your steadfast love. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who is in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord, King of eternal glory.
Praise to you, Lord, King of eternal glory.
Christ became obedient for us to death, even death on a cross. Therefore God exalted him and gave him the name above every name.
Praise to you, Lord, King of eternal glory.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. After they had eaten the supper, Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers, together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
"I am he."
Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," They stepped back and fell to the ground. Again, he asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
"Jesus of Nazareth."
"I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter,
"You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?"
Peter said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered,
"I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying,
"Is that how you answer the high priest?"
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him,
"You are not also one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked,
"Did I not see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said,
"What accusation do you bring against this man?"
They answered,
"If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
They replied,
"We are not permitted to put anyone to death."
This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
"Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?"
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?"
"My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here."
"So you are a king."
"You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
"What is truth?"
After he had said this, Pilate went out to the Jews again and told them,
"I find no case against him, But you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the King of the Jews?"
They shouted in reply,
"Not this man, but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they struck him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him."
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them,
"Here is the man."
When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted,
"Crucify him, crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him."
They answered him,
"We have a law, and according to that law he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him,
"Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?"
"You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin."
From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. Pilate said to the Jews,
"Here is your king."
They cried out,
"Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!"
Pilate asked them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but the emperor."
Kyrie Christe.
Pilate handed Jesus over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the people read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write the King of the Jews, but this man said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another,
"Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it."
This was to fulfill what the scripture said, "They divided my clothes amongst themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother,
"Woman, here is your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Here is your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, in order to fulfill the scripture, he said,
I am thirsty.
A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said,
It is finished.
Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified it so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 weight. They took the body of Jesus. And wrapped it with spices and linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified. And in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
We praise you, O Christ, and we adore you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Powerful day, this Good Friday, where we venerate the cross, the tree of life, beautiful and powerful celebrations. By his wounds we are healed, and we are invited to pray with the crucifix. I'm thinking about this past Tuesday, again, during Holy Week. There's so many celebrations happening. Let's not forget to celebrate. That is, let's not forget to enter into these mysteries to understand how much God loves us. On Tuesday at the Chrism Mass, we were gathered at the cathedral downtown in Ottawa. And during, somehow, there was a beautiful celebration, 130 priests or so. The cathedral was full. Priests and laity, the faithful, and where the priests were renewing their priestly promises and vows. And when we were opening, when we were starting the opening procession, somehow I was in the back, so I got to sit in the sanctuary. I got to see everything. I was sitting beside the amble, which is on the other side of the cathedral, and now I'm looking directly across to the life-size crucifix. So when the Archbishop is doing his homily, I'm thinking about my homily for today. God is good. At the liturgy on Good Friday, when we venerate the cross at our parish, it is profoundly moving to see our fellow parishioners of all ages approach a large cross set down at the center aisle. We line up on either side of the cross, silent and somber. Everyone has their own way of adoring the cross. Some simply bow, some genuflect, some kneel and touch it, some kiss it. The little children follow suit with their families. It's a beautiful moment that nearly always brings tears to my eyes, because this cross symbolizes the very cross on which Jesus died for me. We praise you, O Christ, and we adore you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. In a homily a few years ago, many years ago, this for the celebration of Palm Sunday, Pope Benedict XVI asked, "Who is Jesus of Nazareth for us? What idea do we have of the Messiah? What idea do we have of God?" It is during this very week that we are called to follow our King, who chooses the cross as his throne. We are called to follow Messiah, who promises us not an easy earthly happiness, but the happiness of heaven, of divine beatitude. Again, during this beautiful Holy Week, we will walk with our Lord through the betrayals, the sorrow, and the surrender. We are aware of how this journey ends with his ultimate victory over sin and death. Yet in the days leading up to Easter, we are gently reminded of our own need for salvation from our sins. Again, back to our Chrism Mass on Tuesday, it was a powerful celebration, renewing our priestly promises to God and for you, the people of God. A priest is not his own. The priest is ordained by God and for you to be at service to our brothers and sisters. It's a beautiful day to renew our priestly anniversary. Father Gilles will be celebrating 60 years a priest in 2 years, 58 this year? In 2 years, 60 years as a priest. I'm following on his footsteps there, 15 years this year. It's a powerful, and oftentimes we hear this comment, thank you for your yes. There's many ups and downs in the priesthood, like any other vocation, but they return that same comment to you. Thank you for your yes, for serving your families, for serving the parish, for serving the community. It's not always easy, this way of the cross. Again, walking into a cathedral on Tuesday reminded me that it's kind of a living catechesis. Everything we look at raises our eyes, raises our minds, raises our souls to the very mysteries of God, as it does today as we walk into our church, into our beautiful basilica. What strikes you? What catches your attention? Is it a statue? Is it the stained glass window? Is it the bells that don't ring today? When I first got here almost 4 years ago, it was all the different angels looking after us. And one of the images, one of the paintings I saw at the cathedral on Tuesday night was this beautiful story of the pelican. So I'm looking around. Many of our churches has the story of the pelican. I'm looking for the pelican here. I can't find it. There's different types of birds. We have the turtle doves. St. Joseph has the turtle doves, the pelican. We have the dove, the Holy Spirit. But we're looking for the pelican. Pelican, don't see it. But I'll give you a story about the pelican. The story of the pelican goes like this. The great mother pelican protected her young with all her might, but nothing could protect them from the great famine that came across the land. As she watched her chicks dying beneath her wings, she did the only thing she could. She pierced her own breasts with a long, sharp beak, and blood flowed down upon her flock. Their weak necks strained upward to catch the drops, and as the mother's blood flowed from her side, her children became stronger and came back to life as she herself gave up hers. The story of the pelican goes back all the way to the earliest days of Christianity, back to Egypt, where the Israelites first sprinkled the blood of the lamb on their doorposts, and the angel of death may pass over them, and thus their own firstborn children were spared. Again, if you look at this image of the pelican, you can see her drops of blood that flow from her side. Again, St. Thomas Aquinas called Jesus the P. Pelicane, or sweet, loving, merciful pelican. And all his life, out of love for his own, Jesus gave himself away until he had nothing left to give except his very blood. Jesus suffered and paid a great price, not because of our lives could be bought and sold like merchandise, his for ours. No, Jesus simply loved us so much that he gave everything he had to see us live again. For the result of love, the outcome of love, the fruit of love, the cost of such great love is always one of sacrifice. No one can say for certain then that there is no reason, there is a reason for suffering. We can't say there is a reason for suffering or some kind of meaning to it, as God makes us suffer on purpose or to teach us a lesson or to make us better persons. Again, at the Chrism Mass on Tuesday, I saw, again, many different priests, some I didn't know. I met a couple of new priests studying in the diocese, struggling with their faith. I saw a priest currently on burnout leave. I saw another returning from a time away. I talked with a priest whose mother is currently in a coma, who is not expected to last much longer. I talked with another priest whose parents are very sick and is now making funeral arrangements. We have multiple parishioners now visiting the hospital for pastoral care and our residences, offering care to our brothers and sisters who need community and companionship. Another parishioner knocked on my door this week asking for prayers for her mother, who was battling cancer. She's in tears because the doctors were offering her MAID. We hear of the ongoing wars, the persecution of Christians in many different countries, the Baltimore Bridge that collapsed due to the ship leaving the port. It seems that every time I'm scrolling on Twitter, there's another terrible thing happening in the world. We praise you, O Christ, and we adore you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Again, no one can say there is a reason or logic to our suffering. But we who stand here at this tree of life can say there is a reason to hope, even in our suffering. Jesus, who accompanies us, all of us, the innocent and the guilty, in our suffering, in our joys. Jesus, whose blood brings us all back to life. But there's a darker vision, a darker story to the pelican story. It goes a little like this. Although the mother pelican cares so much for her young, her children strike at her with their own beaks. Out of anger and fear, she kills them. But after 3 days of grieving over what she had done, she pierces her own flesh, and the blood from her side drips upon her children and brings them back to life. Today we begin this beautiful novena to the Divine Mercy. The Chapel of Divine Mercy, St. Faustina, invited us to pray this beautiful image here on the side. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. We see in the gospel the soldier who pierces the side of our Lord Jesus Christ, and out came water and blood, indicating the sacraments of baptism and the most holy Eucharist. O blood and water which gush forth from the heart of Jesus, as a fount of mercy for us, I trust in you. Sometimes we can be like that mother pelican, doing the best we can for those we love, giving all we have to our families, to our work, to our churches and governments, for our friends, and still in the end we are betrayed. Our families fall apart, jobs are lost, leaders become corrupt, and friends leave. Out of anger and fear, hurt and confusion, we strike back and shield ourselves from further pain. And we slowly stop giving ourselves away for fear of losing it all. And as we build that shield around us, making it thicker with suspicion and cynicism and slander and hatred in all kinds of ways that keep us from being vulnerable to another, slowly that light that was once in us begins to fade and grow dim until it suffocates within the walls we have created between us, our God, and the person God created us to be. This is why we come back today to the church, Sunday after Sunday, around the family table, around the altar that sits under the sign of the pelican, the Sacred Heart of Jesus, the shadow of the cross, to be fed once again with the life-giving blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, to be drenched once again by the flood of grace that flows from the side of Jesus on the tree of life, that the walls we have built around our hearts may be softened, that Christ may pierce the hard, resistant skin that we have wrapped around our souls, so that we may too again love one another as he has loved us. Okay, my brothers and sisters, today as the church reminds us of the intensity of Christ's suffering, which symbolizes the intensity of his love, let's renew our trust in God. Let's ask him for the strength we have to embrace our crosses, just as Christ embraced his out of love and as a way to exercise and strengthen our trust in God, continuing our spiritual journey and spiritual renewal. We praise you, O Christ, and we adore you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty.
Let us pray. Almighty and dear living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout all the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our Holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church, to govern the holy people of God.
Almighty and living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for our Bishop Marcel, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Almighty and living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their innermost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Almighty and ever-living God, who make your church every year fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, Sam, Yuan, and Miliana, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church.
Almighty and ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Almighty and ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Almighty and ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, we may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in this world through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right with sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Almighty and ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for those in public office, that God our Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
Almighty and ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurances of peace, and the freedom of religion may, through your gift, be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick and salvation to the dying.
Almighty, near living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because in their hour of need your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the
world. Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Brothers and sisters, for the veneration of the cross, you may kiss or touch the crucifix, bow or genuflect with a short prayer, and I'll invite you to come on up the center aisle and go back the side aisles.
Were you there when they crucified?
shall see me lifted up upon a tree.
So
Let us stand. My brothers and sisters, of the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Feed us now.
We eat this living bread, we drink this saving cup, sign of hope in our broken world, source of lasting love, bread of life, hope of the world, Jesus Christ, our brother, feed us now.
Let us pray. Almighty and living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve us in the works of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have life unceasingly devoted to you through Christ our Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters, may abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people, who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. We ask this through Christ our Lord.